Fire!
Amen and amen.
Amen.
Shout fire!
Fire!
Praise the Lord God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Amen and amen. Are you excited today?
Woo!
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, let's shake hands with someone and then take your seats. Amen. Say, it's so nice to see you.
So nice to see you.
It's so nice to see you. It's not a burial service. Amen. Amen and amen.
So nice to see you.
So nice to see you now. Amen. On a Sunday morning, so nice to see you. Praise God. All right, let's take our seats. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We are very, very honored and delighted to be here. Very honored and delighted to be here. I want to thank the person of the Holy Spirit for the privilege to be here. Amen. Amen. Say thank you, Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Holy Ghost.
We are privileged to have you.
Amen. Amen. I want to thank our most highly esteemed Papa Joshua Aguila.
Amen.
Amen. For the privilege to be here. And of course, our most highly esteemed Mama MBC Joshua Aguila. Say, we love you, Papa, Mama.
Love you, Papa, Mama.
Amen and amen. Amen. Praise God forever. Today, we just want to, share some thoughts with us.
Amen.
And, of course, every Sundays we're always in New York for the first service. But the Spirit of the Lord created the opportunity for us to be here today.
Yeah.
This
service.
Amen. Yeah, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
But we want to look at a particular subject. And what we want to consider today is titled Two Peculiar Accounts. Two Peculiar Healing Accounts. Say it.
Two peculiar healing accounts.
Say it.
Two peculiar healing accounts.
And the reason why they are peculiar is because out of the several healings Jesus manifested, demonstrated, out of the several healings, these two that I want to talk about did not require any condition whatsoever. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Because there is a condition required for healing. But we want to look at these two because for those who meet the requirements for healing are those who have been probably taught about what it takes to receive healing. So they talk about preparing yourself. Maybe there's a healing meeting. Maybe a renowned man of God, graced with the gifts of healing, is having a program. Or a renowned evangelist is having a program, and now he's inviting people. And so they are bringing all manner of sick folks. Sometimes they try to prep the people and prepare them. For instance, there are healing houses today where they teach people the conditions to meet so that when the minister prays for them, they can easily receive their healings. And of course, there have been countless testimonies in that regard, which is very true. But what we want to look at is, what if There is no healing house around you. Or what if there is no healing clinic? You know, we have different names. Some may call it healing school. Some may call it healing clinic. Some may call it a healing home. You know, some may call it mountain of healings. You know, different names like that. So, what if you are not opportune to attend those classes where you are taught on how to receive healing, how to prepare yourself to receiving healing? So what do you do in that case? Now, what if, what we're trying to communicate is, what if the issues you are faced with, the challenge that you are faced with, maybe concerning your health, maybe concerning some other area, is such that you are not even able to go to church? What do you do? See? Because it is very true, it will be very true to say that there are people in the hospitals today who would have loved to come to church.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
They would have loved to be in church.
Sir.
At least so that the minister, whoever he is or she is, can lay hands and, you know, pray for them. And by the way, we would like to thank Pastor Becky. Amen.
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 Pastor Becky, you know, she's our resident pastor. Amen. Amen. So, we want to also thank her for having us on this Sunday morning. Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Becky. So, we want to look at, what do I do?
Yes, sir.
Because if you want to pray for a sick person today, they ask the person, you must have faith.
Yes.
What if I don't even know what faith is?
Exactly.
What if I don't know what faith is? Can I still receive healing? What if I don't know what faith is? Can I still receive healing? Can I be healed at all? If I don't know what faith is. Because that word faith is an English word.
Yes,
really.
Yes, sir.
Now, if I want to minister to a woman, an old woman, or an elderly man in the village who has never experienced the corridors of civilization, does not know how to speak English, and how do I communicate with that person? No matter how I try to speak faith, explain faith in the language of the person. Because you know, there are a lot of missionaries who go to places like Africa. Mm-hmm. And thank God for what many of them do. But if you look at the after crusades, it looks like some of them are just trying to make a show. You don't know whether you're getting
yes,
it.
Yes, sir, we got it.
Because now, thank God for the cameras and they record the healings. So they come here on Christian television and they play and say 20 million people were saved and they were healed. And truly, many were healed.
Yes,
but the question is, were they able to retain the healing? And how many were able to secure even their salvation after receiving it? How many? If you ask a renowned missionary today or evangelist today who goes around the world today and they organize big crusades and win souls, if you ask the man of God 2 years later, Who does he really know by name? They don't really know.
Yeah. So true.
They rather know the pastors around.
Yeah.
But there was a great man of God by the name of Dr. T.L. Osborne. Even in his writings, he will mention their names.
Wow.
He will write their names. I mean, even after the people received their healing, he went beyond the crusade to know them personally.
Yeah.
Sometimes he will even wear their clothes.
Yeah.
Like even when he visited places like Kenya, or maybe he goes to Ghana, he will even dress like them. He will walk on the streets like, he will visit their home, sometimes eat their food. An American, Dr. T.L. Osborne. Sometimes, of course, Evangelist Rehan Bonnke did the same thing. But not many are that personal with the people. To see that 15 years after the crusade, 20 years after the crusade, they are able to still retain what they received. So I want to show you, because the people that Jesus healed, for instance, looking at the people Jesus raised from the dead, the people he raised from the dead still died again. Yeah, they died again. Because he raised Lazarus from the dead. You can't say Lazarus is still alive today in the earth. He finally died. When he went to the city of Nain and he saw a widow whose only child died, only son died, and they carried him in the pyre to go and bury him, he intercepted the burial procession and raised the guy up. You can't say the guy is still alive today in the earth. He still died again. And even Jesus, who healed him, died too. Although we know he's alive, he rose and came back in the flesh, no doubt. But how about the people he healed? See? So we want to look at two peculiar accounts in the Bible that if you give your attention to whatever you came here with,
yes, sir,
it might just leave you.
Amen.
Like I said, we said might because you are the one to make the decision. The Bible says, as Jesus taught, like we're teaching now, the power of God was present to heal. As he taught, the power of God was present. So the power of God is present. As we're teaching you now. But in that crusade, in Luke chapter 5, only one guy received, yet the power was present. And don't let that be the case here. We want everyone to receive. It could be you need healing in your job. It could be healing for your finances. It could be healing for your health. If you just give us your attention, you are the one to determine it. Let's show you. You know, because sometimes we think that there are certain requirements we must have met first before God does something. For instance, sometimes we think God must know me first. God must be familiar with my case before he does something. Does he?
No.
So go to Luke chapter 8. Let's read these two peculiar accounts. And it so happened that they are so into each other. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
You call it the journey of healing. It was a journey. Now, are you in Luke chapter 8?
Yes, sir.
Look at verses 41. It says, and behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. So he was an overseer. Okay, read on now. And he fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house. This is a senior pastor. Jairus, to be a ruler of the synagogue, meant that he's like Nicodemus. These are like pastors, senior pastors, not just lay members. This is not just an elder. This is an overseer. In other words, for Jairus to be a ruler of the synagogue meant that he was a priest, an ordained priest. These are the kind of people they look at and they pick and make them high priest. So by estimation, he was more or less like a chief priest. So he was not just a low profile fellow. This is a man who knew the tenets of the law. He understood, I mean, he was a teacher, because rulers are teachers. When Nicodemus met Jesus in John chapter 3, Jesus said, are you a teacher of the Jews and you don't know these things? See, so Jesus knows and acknowledges that these folks, people who are rulers, they are highly privileged. Now, he came to Jesus and prostrated to Jesus and begged him to come to his house. You just think about it. That a general overseer of another ministry is coming. And this general overseer is someone who has probably invited you to come and preach. Now, you find the general overseer that is greatly revered, honored, prostrated before Jesus. And he said, please come to my house. Not that he even prostrated to worship Jesus. He said, please come to my house. Okay, come to my house for what? Now, see you. For he had what? An only daughter. About what? 12 years old. And what? She was dying. But as he went, the multitude struck him. So, you see, here's the problem. The people saw Jairus. There was a multitude. Jairus was not, you see, there is a problem that a man can face. And the man will ignore shame.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
This is a highly, don't forget, Nicodemus, if you want to know how rulers are of the Jews, you need to understand that if you study the life of Nicodemus, you know how rulers behave. They don't walk publicly. They don't walk on the street publicly. You don't see them in a public place. They are too revered to be in the public. For you to see somebody like that in a public place, it must be a special occasion. Now, to see a man of such dignity, and people like that, the only time they can take a stroll is in the night. It's in the night. And to see a man like that, publicly, lying down, unashamedly, even the multitude, this is a ruler of the synagogue. Why is he prostrating before Jesus? There is a problem that a man can face, that the man will forget dignity. May that never come your way.
Amen.
Amen. And there are many like that. We've met some high profile people in this state who have knelt down before us. A small boy like Brother Osi. All glory to the name of the Lord. And say, please, please, please talk to your God. They say each time you talk to God, he hears you. I say, he does.
Amen.
And the Lord glorified his name.
Amen.
But the point is that person that you consider a privilege to know, that person that has bodyguards everywhere, that to even come close, it can be very challenging. Unashamedly broke the protocols and prostrated before Jesus and said, please come to my house. His only daughter. So that means this was a man who had no son. The only thing his wife could give him was just a daughter. And now she's 12 years old and now sick, dying. Wonderful. Now, already, he didn't even have a son. Which means, even if he dies, there will be nobody to bear his name.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
There'll be nobody to bear his name. Now, he even has a daughter. At least, thank God he even has a daughter. At least, when she marries, then he can have a son-in-law. So, the one through whom he can probably even have a son now, he is dying at 12. Man. This is a ruler who blessed the people every Sabbath. Now, he has no blessing to pronounce on his own daughter.
Wow.
It's amazing. There is a crisis a minister can face. He will forget whether he or she is a pastor. May you never be in that group. If you give us the attention, you will never be in that group. Okay. He says, for he had an only daughter about 12 years old, and she was dying. That's the point. That every second that ticked, life was sniffing out of her. Every second. Boy. What condition? Now, remember, there were no oxygen tanks in those days. So, you couldn't say you can do like a CPR or something to keep her. No, he said she was dying. And it's something to mark. Now, if you notice, he didn't say she's about to die. He said she was dying. That means every second that ticked, life was going out of her. So even as at the time he came to see Jesus, she was already dying. As at the time he prostrated, she was dying. So she was closer to death every time the clock ticked. Every time the clock ticked. Think about it. It was not something he ever planned for his household. That's the point. The Bible talks about the evil day. Well, what do you do when it comes? The question is, are you even preparing for it? When we come to church all the time, they think we are crazy people. They don't know we are preparing. Because when the storm of life hits, some of us may never fall. I know I will never fall. Or some will go under. Some will be looking, scavenging for help. Now, the guy became like a scavenger. Prostrated before Jesus and was saying, please come to my house. And it's amazing that when this thing struck, how come being a ruler, he didn't know? He was a man who was always in church. He was a ruler of a church. That's the point. How can this thing happen to her? And she goes to church all the time. Well, this was even a ruler of the church. He opened the doors of the church all the time. So it's not about whether you come to church, how often you come to church. It is whether or not you receive into you what you need as you come to church. Because don't fool yourself. The storms are coming. The storms, notice, the storms did not hit him, a person. The storm did not strike his wife. The storm struck his only daughter. The only thing that came from him. Isn't that amazing? On a Christmas day, some people are crying that somebody just died. We are celebrating, they are crying. How come they couldn't sense that death was coming during the festive period? That was the ruler of the church. But the storms were coming. Because the way some people behave in church, it doesn't look like they know that the evil day is coming. There's no clue. Such that even to come to church, they are even doing pastor a favor. Oh, you are not doing pastor a favor. It is even for your own good. Because that thing that is making you not have time for church, when it finally hits, when circumstances hit you, you will even forget that thing. You will forget whether they put you on schedule. You will forget schedule. And have you not noticed? It is when the circumstance hit, that's when your supervisor say, it's okay. Go and say to yourself, this is the same supervisor who will not let you go off until when something is strong. That's when dinner begin to express sympathy. So your supervisor could be this nice. So how come they became nice in the period of tragedy? Why are they nice? Can't you see the devil all in it? Now, it so happened that as he went, the Bible says the multitudes thronged him. They followed him. When he agreed to go to the house of Jairus, the multitudes followed. They wanted to come and see. This is their pastor. There is a matter now. He has an issue. Let's go and find out why he had to even come to see Jesus. So the multitudes were all going to the house of the ruler of the synagogue. He was the people's man. But even the multitude could not help him. He only needed the help of one person. This was a man who was ruling in multitudes, but none of them could help. So no matter how you are the people's man, there is a crisis that can hit you. The multitudes can't help. The people can't help you. They can't help you at all. They can't. Yet you know people. In fact, you want the man of the year in your city. Everybody, you know people, they do business with you. But when you get home today, just sit down in that your chair in your house and think about what the enemy can strike you. Think about what the enemy can strike you with that can make no one come to your aid. What is that thing that is dear to you that even your best friend is not able to understand? Think about it. Could it be it's closer now? And maybe that's why the Lord is trying to make us share this with you. See, if you study what Jesus said, in John chapter 10, verse 10, he says, I am come that they might have life. Why? Because the lifespan of the children of Israel was short. Why? Because they were all under the curse of the law. So they didn't live long. Jesus came to expand their life. It means age long life. Eternal life there means age long life. So that means they had a short lifespan. So Jesus came to increase it. Notice that. He knew the people. Because they broke the law, they were under the curse of the law. And by breaking the law, that's what the Bible calls sin. Sin is the transgression of the law. And the wages of sin, the Bible says, is death. So, and the Bible says they were all their lifetime subject to bondage because of the fear of death. The fear of death terrorized them. They didn't live long. So Jesus came to help them out. Came to expand their life. So the lepers, like this one now, she was dying already at 12. At 12 years old. You mean even death has no sympathy even for a child. At 12, she was already dying. Your child is just 16. Do you know what can happen tomorrow? Do you know what can happen tomorrow? Okay, now, let's show you something. Verses 43. Now, a woman having a flow of blood for 12 years, who had spent all her livelihood on physicians and could not be healed by any. Now, here's the point. Did you notice? It's really back to back here. Now, did you notice? A man, Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, a pastor, an overseer of the church, had a daughter who was dying at the age of 12. Now, we're being introduced to a woman whose sickness is as old as Jairus' daughter. Maybe Jairus was married 12 years earlier, or maybe 13 years earlier. But the day Jairus' daughter was conceived was the day this woman's sickness began. And the woman's sickness is as old as another person's daughter. You mean people can be sick that long? You know, people can be sick that long. Man. People can be sick that long. And we're not even told the woman with the issue of blood had a child. We're not even told. Nobody would want to even marry that kind of person. So for 12 years, she has already been dying. This one, she got to age 12 and began to die. And now here's the pastor of the church hurriedly running to Jesus to intervene in the life of his dying daughter who began to die at age 12. Imagine if she crossed paths with the woman with the issue of blood. The woman said, don't worry, for me I've been sick already for 12 years. I mean, she was just stealing blood. Blood was just going out of her for 12 years. Now, the Bible says she spent all her livelihood on physicians. Now, you need to understand that physicians are important.
Yes, sir.
And if you study the scriptures carefully, when the Bible says, is there no balm in Gilead? Are there no physicians? You discover that even the word physicians does not necessarily refer to doctors. He's referring to priests, ministers, anointed ministers. Because by law, only the priest could pronounce anyone cleansed. So they were physicians by reason of the anointing upon them. And there were prophets too, who were also in this category. There were prophets who could restore people. Come on, Elisha, didn't he restore the health of the dead child?
Yes, sir.
Please answer.
Yes, sir.
That made him a physician.
Yes, sir.
Isaiah had to prepare herbs for King Hezekiah so that he can get well. That made him a physician. The words spoken by prophets made the people well. I mean, come on. Proverbs 4 verses 20. What does it say? Proverbs 4 verses 20. It says, my son, right?
Yes.
Pay attention to my words. Incline thy ears unto my sayings. Keep them before your eyes. Do not let it depart from the midst of your heart. Why? It says, because they are life unto those who find them, and medicine to their bodies. Medicine to their flesh. Medicine. The sayings of the Lord, the words of the Lord is medicine. See, the word of the Lord is medicine. So the one who carries the word of the Lord to come and give to you is a physician.
Yes, sir.
You see? But now, so don't think when he says she spent all that she had on physicians, is referring to the fact that she spent all that she had on medical doctors. No, he's saying she spent all that she had on ministers. Jairus was one of them. Jairus was a minister. He was a ruler of the synagogue.
Yes, sir.
So, by estimation, he was one of the people who carried the words of life to come and give to the people, and the word was supposed to be medicine. But notice, she spent all that she had. So she probably had met Jairus before. And Jairus probably told her, sow a seed, you'll be healed. And she did so. If you read Matthew chapter 23, Jesus was swearing for the Pharisees. He said, woe unto you. You extort money even from widows. You extort money from the people. Yet you make their circumstances worse. He says, this woman spent all that she had on physicians. Oh, maybe the woman never met Jairus, but I wish she knew who was beside Jesus. He probably looked like the people, the physicians she has met in church. Now the physician needs the help from Jesus. And the woman did not know that Jairus had already prostrated before Jesus, begging him for help. Oh, if this woman had known this is who they are, she probably would not spend a penny. You know, we know of a precious sister who was told to pay about $2,000 for deliverance. And they said, they told her the reason why she has to pay that money is because they want to appease the spirits that were tormenting her. Well, she came here and the Lord delivered her for free.
Amen.
I said, isn't that amazing? God delivered you for free. She said, brother, I'm so fine. I'm glad I'm free now. I don't have to pay.
Amen.
See? There are physicians and there are physicians.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Wow. She spent all that she had for 12 years on pastor. In church. Not knowing that even the pastor needs help from Jesus. You see what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2? He said, I came in demonstration of the spirit and power so that your faith does not rely in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. And what is the power of God? The gospel. He said, it is the power of God unto salvation. The power of God can save any man. See, the power of God can save any man. So they knew Jesus had the power in words. He had the power in words. See, he had
the power in words.
They knew everything he said carried power.
Yes.
But the others, they were after more. And yet made the conditions of the people worse. And are you one of them? Sometimes, in all honesty, I don't want to say we get angry, but we do sometimes. When we hear people say, I've been to many churches, I've been to many places, I've been to this, so now they referred me to you. And I always say, Lord, don't let me be like the others.
Amen.
Let this one have a testimony.
Amen.
Because such a lady now will go and meet another man of God and say, I've been to other men of God, and the last person she checked, it was me. No. Let it be that I'm the last and the final.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
So when you hear someone say, I've been to many churches, I've been to many, that means those ministers were physicians. And instead of making a circumstance better, they made it worse. Notice, she spent all that she had. But what Jesus had left, she took. See? So people, you find out that, I've met a lady before who said, Brother, see, you don't understand. Brother, see, I used to give. I said, so what about now? She said, I don't have anymore. And I said, what do you mean you don't have anymore? You have. She said, Brother, see, you don't understand. When I say I don't have any more, I know what I'm saying, that I don't have any more. I said, I don't understand what you mean, that you don't have any more. She said, Brother, I'll say, there's nothing I did not do. The man of God will say this for me. I got them the church, I got them church building. I paid for the refurnishing. I paid for the furniture in the church. I did this. In fact, the car pastor is driving. I bought it for him. I don't have any. This other one said, I should bring this. I give. I told them when I hit it, say, wonderful. Is it wrong to give? No. So, you see why I said to the Lord, I don't want to be an ordinary Christian.
I don't want to be an ordinary Christian.
Man, I don't know. Maybe
I
that's
don't want to be an ordinary Christian.
But I don't want to be an ordinary Christian. Okay. Here's the point. Said, now, a woman having a flow of blood for 12 years who has spent all her livelihood on physicians and could not be healed. You see the word healed there? That would tell that these physicians were ministers.
Yes, sir.
Because what medical science will give you is relief, not healing. Because healing is spiritual. That would tell that the minister, the physicians, were ministers. He said, and could not be hit by any. Oh, may you never be in that
community. Amen.
People should meet you and they are left.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't matter how you start. Okay. Anyway, she came from behind and touched the borders of his garment. Now, it's strange here. That she just came and touched the borders of his garment. Now, for you to understand what can give her that boldness to come to touch the hem of Jesus' garment, you need to look at Mark chapter 5. So put your marker here. Let's look at Mark chapter 5. Let's see the same story here from verses 25. Mark chapter 5 from verses 25. Don't close Luke chapter 8. We'll go back to it. Mark chapter 5. Verse 25. He said, now a certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years and had suffered many things from many physicians. She had spent all that she had and was no better, or rather grew worse. So there are some ministers whose anointing makes matters worse in people's lives. You see? Not us here. Okay. When she heard about Jesus, she came from behind him in the crowd and touched him. Now, notice, she heard. No wonder she was able to come. What have people heard? But what was the hearing about that she heard about Jesus that was different from the others that she had gone to patronize before? She probably had heard. He gives freely. He does not even ask for money. Because if Jesus had requested for a seed, she would not even qualify. She would not qualify. So you need to understand. Look up, please. It is not what you bring to church that makes you deserve healing. That's what you're trying to say. It is not what you give to God that makes God move to healing you. Somebody said, but Jesus was told somebody built them a synagogue. That's why he must go. No, Jesus already was on his way coming. If you read that story of the centurion with his servant, Jesus already said he was coming. So telling him that, you have to go because he built us a synagogue. It was immaterial. He already was on his way there. But he appreciated that the guy did something. As a matter of fact, even his giving in church did not stop his servant from being sick. So you see, that you give in church, please listen carefully.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Because you can give in church and be faced with a serious crisis. Yes. You can give in church and be faced with a serious crisis. It doesn't mean crisis will not come. But you see, that's where now you'll be able to tell whether you are in the right place or not. Whether you are with the right man of God or not. Otherwise, you might just end up spending all. And instead of getting better, you are getting worse. So it is possible to be in a place where you are spending all and things are not better in your life. No, not here.
Not here.
Not in this place. So what is the anointing? What's the anointing you carry? Is it the anointing that makes people's lives better? Or the anointing that makes people's lives worse?
Yeah.
I carry the anointing that improves people. Well, you don't sound like
I carry the anointing that improves people.
Yes, that makes people's lives better.
And
I attend a church where people's lives are improved. In every area of their
life.
Because if you can be stable spiritually, then you will be stable in every area of your life. Physically, yeah. Okay, now, she had heard about Jesus. Then came and touched him. She heard about Jesus. Now, the same Jairus' story. If you go to verses 21 of Mark chapter 5, you see that story there. But you see the way Peter here was the one narrating the account to Mark. And Mark was writing it down. So this is how Peter was narrating the story. Now, verse 21. Now, when Jesus had crossed over again by boat to the other side, a great multitude. So after he healed the demoniac, he was... You know, the people of the country or the gatherers told him, leave, go, leave our land. So he entered the boat and was going. So when he got to the banks of the other side, that's when he was accosted. How did they know he was coming? Okay. When he got to the other side, a great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed, and she will live. And Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him. He said, come and lay your hands on her, and she will be healed. Now, listen. This is even a pastor of a church. How about his own hands? How about his own hands? You mean his hands did not carry healing? Yet he will stand as the ruler of the synagogue and pronounce blessings on the people. You mean his hands did not carry healing? Listen.
Yes, sir.
Many Christians are broke today. Because they don't understand this. Many Christians are dying. What do you carry in your hands? Some are doing jobs they have no business whatsoever with. It's because of the condition of their hands. They are in church. They serve in church. Jairus was serving the church. His hands were empty. May that not be your God.
Amen. Amen.
Now, go to Luke chapter 8. So she came and touched the border of his garment, verse 44. And immediately her flow of blood stopped. Now, follow this carefully. See something. Verse 45. And he said, "Who touched me?" Who touched me? Who touched me? Look, if you reverse this story to the negative, it will mean that there is a touch that can withdraw your financial blessing.
Wow.
You didn't get it.
Yeah.
Please wake up, don't sleep. Wake up. There is a touch that someone can touch you and take what you have.
Yes, sir.
Because the woman touched Jesus and took what Jesus had. Jesus said, "Who touched me?" So you mean no angel could watch over Jesus to protect Jesus from someone touching him and taking what he had. And the touch was done unknowingly. That's the point.
Yeah.
Who is touching you unknowingly and taking from you what you were supposed to use for another?
Yeah.
Jesus said, "Who touched him?" How? Thank God he knew somebody touched him. What if he had gotten to Jairus' house and nothing happened? Hey! Thank God immediately said, "Who?" You see what? In all honesty, this is the reason why some men of God don't talk to people. When they are preparing for a program, they don't want to see anyone. Countless times we've heard some men of God who would say that when they are coming, when they are going for a meeting, they don't touch, they don't let anyone come near them. You must be someone very, very chosen by God to even carry their Bible. They don't let people come. Even if you want to go and greet them, they'll do bless you. They don't want people to touch them. Because it is because of this story, really. That's why you see some men of God. They don't want people to touch them.
Wow. Yes, sir.
They don't want people to come near them. Jesus said, "Who touched me?" Who is touching me? Who touched me? And that's how some people, they lost the control.
Wow.
Because somebody touched them and took it. The thing here is not that you are not trusting. The problem is not that you are too trusting. That's not a problem. The problem is that even the one that you did not anticipate touched you.
Yeah.
You understand? Because if Jesus had met the woman, she didn't look like someone you could even trust. So the thing is not the matter of, you know, I'm too trusting, that's my problem. No, that's not the problem. The problem is that even the one you did not even know, to even ever think of even trusting, touched you and took what you have. That's the point. He says, "Who touched me? Who did?" Now, let me show you something. When all denied it, you see that? Yeah, they were touching him. But they all denied. No, I didn't touch you. But they were touching. If you read the account of Mark, the Bible says everyone was touching him.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Now they all denied. I didn't touch you.
Yes, sir.
So that means the way Jesus reacted,
yeah,
he made the people begin to say, "Ah, no, no, we didn't touch you." But they were touching him all this while.
Yeah.
Because to throw someone means to touch the person. But now they all say we didn't touch you. They all say we didn't touch you. See? So even the one who is touching you can't deny. Now, Peter and those with him said, Master, the multitude strong and press you. You see that? The people who were denying, the apostle said, the people who were touching him, Master, look, this thing is not an issue. Look at the multitude. They are pressing you, sir. That means to press requires touching.
Yes, sir.
And now, Master, you're asking me who touched me? What kind of question is that? They were actually saying to Jesus, don't ask him. Please don't be angry. Don't say we call you stupid. But that question, it sounds silly. Look at verses 46. Let's read together.
But
Jesus said, somebody touched me. He said, I'm not talking about these people here. Somebody touched me. It takes someone to take something from you. It takes somebody to take some. Listen carefully.
Yes, sir.
Some of you are sleeping your life away because somebody already took what you were supposed to have.
No!
You are still sleeping.
No.
On a Sunday morning. Meanwhile, that thing you were supposed to live long. You see, Jesus had something that could make people live longer. One woman took it. Meanwhile, it was made for the whole nation. One woman took it.
Wow.
Pay attention to what we're telling you.
Yes, sir.
Because the thing that you were supposed to make progress with, the thing you were supposed to make progress with, somebody took it. You wonder why your children are wayward, acting the way they are acting? Because what you were supposed to use for them, somebody took it. No, it was a woman. She was not even a girlfriend. She was not even a girlfriend. Not a girlfriend to Jesus. She was not even a pastor. She was someone who had a plague. So by estimation, she was a cursed woman. So even a cursed person can hijack a blessing and change their circumstances. You for whom the blessing is meant for, you are sleeping. She didn't prostrate to Jesus. The one who prostrated that Jesus wanted to give it to. The world did not prostrate, hijacked it. So whether you realize it or not, a man's blessings can be hijacked. That's why some people today, they can never be well. You know why? Because what the pastor was supposed to use, somebody took it. So they can never be well. They will always be sick till they die. There's some people like that. Sometimes the touch can come through a phone call. You are going to pray for someone, that's when somebody calls you. Phone call. It's all about contact and transmission. And of course, during ceremonies, that's where touch is really done. Maybe like a wedding ceremony, birthday, or maybe they just carry the baby, fine baby. The touch is going on. And the innocent baby cannot say like Jesus, who touched me? Mama, they are touching me, oh! Mommy, they are taking it. The baby cannot say anything. The best baby can do is just to cry. They say, oh, my baby, I need to breastfeed her and give her food. Somebody just collected something. Jesus said, who touched me? Somebody touched me. Somebody. And Jesus, I thought you are God. You should know everything. He said, look, somebody touched me. I don't know who. But somebody here touched me. Somebody here. So your enemy is not even far away. Somebody close. The one who wants to harm me is close. Even in church. He said, somebody touched me. Isn't amazing. The people who talk about men of God having extramarital affairs are even ladies that the pastor never said hello to. You go and find out. So how did you know he's that? I don't know. Don't you know Suzanne? He asked Suzanne, what did you? Did he meet the pastor? No. I know. This is from a reliable source. That's a touch there. Somebody's touching pastor. Somebody touched me. Okay, now. This is for I perceive. And perceive requires knowledge, perception. It requires knowledge. For I perceive power going out from me. See, here's the point. For power to go out of him will mean that Jesus was losing life. See, he was going to restore the dying.
Yeah.
What he was going to give to the dying that he had, somebody took it. So he himself was now a victim of what he was going to fix. Somebody took what he said, virtue, power is going out of me. I see it going out of me. I'm losing power. And if you look at virtue, it has to do with strength. That means physically, he suddenly became tired. He was becoming tired. It was somebody who told the legion, get out 30 minutes ago. Now, he's beginning to feel tired. Tired. Because the Holy Spirit cannot move on a tired body. He's beginning to feel tired. And the lady was getting stronger. He is feeling tired. He said, man, who is touching me? Who is touching me? So there's a touch that makes people tired.
Yeah.
There's a touch that is making people tired. So it is one touch that made them become tired of life. So they decided to give up. One touch. So they used to be alive. Now they are sleeping their life away because somebody touched them. One touch is making some people sleep away. One touch. He said, who touched me? Who touched me? Who touched me? Okay. Now, when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and now falling down before him. She declared to him in the presence of all the people the reason she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. Oh. Even the apostles, they felt so foolish. He's correct, somebody touched him. I thought we've been protecting him enough. We've protected him enough. We've defended the man of God enough. He said, there's a touch that you don't know about. Now, notice, when the woman saw that she cannot be hidden, that means she would have remained hidden. That was her intention. That means Jesus kept saying, somebody touch me. Who is touching me? Who touched? Jesus kept insisting. Now, notice, when she saw she could not be hidden, so that means people say, no, not me. I was looking behind when he passed. But when he got to her throne, she could not deny. She said, I did. How did she know that her touching Jesus was the one Jesus was referring to? Because she knew what happened to her.
Yes, sir.
She knew what happened to her when Jesus touched, when she touched Jesus. But what Jesus had, or what she took from Jesus, was what Jesus was going to use for somebody else. So now, the one with the 12 years old sickness is now free, while the one that is 12 years old is still dying. So here, it looks like, look, I was the one who was sick first. I've been sick for 12 years. You've been healthy for 12 years. It's just this 12th year that you started falling sick. The woman with the issue of blood will say to the lady, I've been sick right from the day you were born. So I need to receive my own first. You see, Jairus felt that he was in a more desperate situation. The one who was more desperate. So, which means Jairus didn't need to even tell Jesus to come to his house.
Yeah.
If he had even touched Jesus, that would have been it.
Yeah.
So inviting a man of God to your house is not what, sister, bless me. Yeah, bless.
Okay.
Now, see what Jesus said in verses 48. And he said to her, "Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Now, look up, please. You see, this is the first time the word faith is mentioned. The woman with the issue of blood did not know anything about faith. She was not someone who was always in church to attend sermons, to go and buy lessons of faith series. No. It was Jesus who was telling her, "What you just did is faith." She didn't know. So she was probably someone who stumbled on something. And Jesus said, "That's what is required in the kingdom." This kind of action, hearing and acting, is what is required. See, hearing and acting is what is called faith, as far as Jesus was concerned. That's what he was saying. See, this is the kind of people we need. No wonder you were able to take from me. You did not only hear, you acted. Now, even as we're talking now, can you act that even as he's talking, I'm free?
Yes, sir.
As I'm listening to him as he's preaching, my finances are healed.
Yes.
She heard and acted.
Yes, sir.
She heard and acted. But previously, she was blaming the physicians that she gave. But there is a sickness that giving is not what is required. It is an act. You need to act. You see what Apostle Smith Wigglesworth said? Faith is an act.
Yeah.
It's an act. She heard and acted. She heard and acted. She did not allow the personality of Jesus to intimidate her. She acted. See? For Jairus, his dignity was his limitation. He could not act. He felt the best thing is to approach Jesus with courtesy. "Please come to my house. Please come to my house." But faith is an act.
Yes, sir.
Faith is an act.
And it doesn't need to be preached to you.
No,
yes, sir.
You are the one to determine how desperately you want it. It is an act.
It is an act.
No. Jesus said, "On the basis of that, go in peace." You see, the end product of faith is peace. He said, "Go in peace." That means go and live in peace. So Jesus was saying, everything around you, aside this healing, that was once a trouble in your life will receive peace. Remember, the trouble was that Jesus said, "Peace be still," and there was a great calm. So when Jesus said, "Here, go in peace," he knew beyond the healing, she already had financial troubles. So when he says, "Go in peace," that means in peace prosperity came.
Amen.
Everything she lost was restored.
Amen.
Now, she did not fast, that's one. She did not even pray. She only made a decision to act. No pray. Someone said, "Let's play worship song. Let's worship the Lord so that the Lord will move and heal us." She did not do worship. Do worship. Now, for Jesus to say, "Who touched me?" That will tell you that she was someone that God did not know. Not even Jesus knew her. Sometimes we think the man of God needs to know us first before God will have sympathy on us and heal us. The man of God didn't know. Rather, Jesus is saying, who touched me? Somebody touched me. That means it was someone that Jesus didn't know. And when she introduced herself, he said, daughter. Notice that. Notice what Jesus called her. He said, daughter. Yeah. Daughter. He calls her a daughter. Why? Because she was someone who acted on what she had. So you are truly a son or a daughter of God if you act on what you hear.
Yes, sir.
When you act on what you hear, you are truly a son. And a daughter of God. Like this sister, she did a YouTube, a Facebook video, and we had the opportunity to see it because we received the prompt. And we saw it, Sister Michelle,
yeah.
And we were watching and we saw the way she was preaching, and she sounded like Brother Ozzy.
Yeah.
And we even saw the way she did a salvation prayer. I said, oh man. She acted. He says, when you do, then you are a true daughter. Then you are a true son. He said, daughter. This was a woman who suffered an issue of blood. So she was not a daughter then. So you are not a child of God until you act on what you hear. Until you act, God cannot acknowledge who you are. Because it is the one who succeeds that is celebrated by the parents. You see, you are truly my child. You are truly my son. Jesus did the same thing too. She acted. Yes, she was not someone who was really educated about the things of the Spirit. But she acted on the one she has heard. When are you going to act on the one you have heard? So say, I listen to preachers. My channel is always Christian television. When I go, say, okay, do you even listen? Well, whenever I'm less busy, I hear. Okay, the one you have heard, have you ever acted on it? Because if you do, you will receive your miracle. She did not pray. She was not a member of Jesus' ministry. Not a member. She only heard for the first time and came and received. Those who were already members, nothing. You can know church history. Your church history, that means the ministry you are part of. You can know the history of that church and still be miserable. Miserable. Why even those who are coming are progressing? Don't say, hey, this pastor, he knows those people that he's helping now. We know, in fact, we've been accused of that before. Brother Austin knows those he helps now. He knows the people he can pray for. There was one sister who told me, Brother Austin, please, now that you are about to pray for me, please take me serious. she said that to me, please take me serious. I said, well, what do you mean? She said, please just take me serious. I said, what do you mean? Then the Lord began to tell me what she meant. She didn't say. So I said, this is what you mean. After the Lord told me, so I told her, this is what you mean. She said, yes, but please don't be angry. Please take me serious. It made me laugh. And she said, she was honest enough to say, because Rosie, there are sometimes when you pray for some people, I know you are not serious. Why pray for them? I said, I'm not serious. She said, when you pray it, I know you are not serious for this one. But I've seen you pray, re-prayer for this one. Please pray. Please pray, re-prayer for me. And I thought about it. There was someone who said, oh, Rosie, I like the time, each time you pray for me. I said, why? He said, you are always very sincere. So I said, thank you. So there's such a thing called sincere and insincere prayer. He said, you are always very sincere. Ah, my brother still prays sincere when he's praying. Oh, I wish that sister could meet this brother. She will not say, brother, say, please take me serious. She said, please take me serious. Please pray. Please be serious with me. I was surprised she says. No, that was not the case here. She had to be serious. She was the one who needed to be serious, not the minister. Someone say, you are just cracking joke, just making all of us laugh. Okay, you don't crack joke. You came because of what God has graced us with that we carry. Even when we're cracking joke, we can be very unserious, but can you be serious and receive? Because Jesus was just going on his own. Maybe Jesus was asking Jairus, how long has that your daughter been sick? Ah, what really happened? This and that. Then he said, ah, who touched me? See? So not as if he was serious with the lady, but the lady was serious with Jesus. That's the point. How serious are you? Before you start blaming the man of God, they are praying for me, I'm not getting better. No, you, the person, you are probably the problem. Okay, can you be like the one with the issue of blood for once? If you have suffered many things in the hands of different men of God, can you for once become serious? You see why that woman, with all that she spent, she did not get better because she was never serious with it. She felt that all that she's spending will do it. It is not what you give in church that makes you free. Take your condition serious.
Yes, sir.
Which means take what the man of God carries serious for your condition.
Yes, sir.
You know what you are going through, which is why you are here today. Even if you see us crack joke, take what we carry serious.
Yes, sir.
She heard and acted unashamedly. Someone say, what if it did not work? Thank God it worked. So, what if it works? And it will always work. Because the word works. Say, the word works.
The word works.
Jesus said, go in peace. Now let's begin to close with this. Verse 49. While he was still speaking, still talking to the lady, that means he still wanted to say more beyond go in peace. Someone came from the ruler of the synagogue's house saying to him, your daughter is dead. Do not trouble the teacher. Don't trouble him again. Your daughter is dead. Man. See this woman? She has spoiled the whole thing. She delayed Jesus, and Jesus said, power is gone out of me. Now my daughter is dead. Even if I bring him to the house, he can't do anything anymore. Can't you see? He's even having a conversation with the woman. The Bible says, but when Jesus heard it, he said to him, do not be afraid, only believe. So now, here's the point. Faith, believe. To one, it was our faith that made our home. To the other, the Lord was asking him, just believe. Notice what Jesus is trying to show us here. When the circumstance is hopeless, faith is not what you need. Faith is not what you need. Preachers say, have faith. No. When the circumstance is hopeless, faith is not what you need. Because when the circumstance is hopeless, you are not motivated to act.
Yeah.
Don't forget, it was the faith that Jairus had that made him come to Jesus in the first place.
Yeah.
It was faith that made him act by going to Jesus. But what he needed faith for, he is now dead. What his faith was supposed to produce in his life was for Jesus to come and make his daughter well. Now, the daughter for whom he exercised his faith towards Jesus to come and heal. He is now dead. Oh, he was already broken. So Jesus would have made a mistake if he said, have faith, have faith. That's what many Christians do. We preachers, that's what we still try to tell the people. Still have faith. No, can't you see? The faith made them come in the first place. Now they have heard that the circumstance is worse. That's not when to tell them, have faith. Jesus said, only believe. Just believe. You've already exercised your faith. Just believe. Just believe she will be well. So, when do you need to apply belief? When the circumstance is hopeless. But you see, the mistake Christians are making today is they try to use belief for something they ought to have used faith for. And then use faith for something that is already hopeless, that they were supposed to only believe. And what did the Bible say about belief? It says, nothing shall be impossible to he who believes. Some say, I thought nothing shall be impossible to the one who has faith. No. The reason why that is so, that nothing, the Bible never said nothing shall be impossible to the one who has faith, is simply because faith is an act. You have to act it. You don't need to be told or encouraged. See, when it comes to faith, no one needs to encourage you. You have to make what? The decision. The word faith there is the word pistis, which means what? Persuasion. You need to be persuaded. Nobody needs to encourage you to be persuaded. You have to make the decision. See, when I first came to America, I slept in JFK for 2 days because I didn't know anybody. But I had a persuasion that in this land we will make it. There was a persuasion. I almost ended up in a shelter, but there was a persuasion. I said, man, I didn't come to America to end up in a shelter. There was a persuasion. I was kicked out a month after I lived with the family I was living with a pastor. He kicked us in the cold. It was very cold. New York, very cold. But you see, there was a persuasion in me. I didn't allow it to get to the point where I now had to believe God. That's the point. The woman with the issue of blood, her case, even though it lasted 12 years, it was still not a hopeless case. She was someone who knew how to act. She knew how to act by giving, thinking that giving will be all God needs to heal her, only to find out it is not in your giving. Rather, the giving can make the enemy attack you more. But one of the things that will make the enemy back out is you back your giving with your faith, your full persuasion. I know I'm giving this thing. I know I'm doing this thing. So for the woman with the issue of blood, her faith, her circumstance was not a hopeless one. So she still had faith. She was the one who needed faith. She didn't even know what it was, but Jesus called it faith. But the one whose daughter was just sick for a few hours automatically had a hopeless case. The one whose circumstance had lingered on for many years did not need belief. Because she, as far as she was concerned, as long as she has strength in her, she will still act. But it is if she had acted and discovered that even touching the hem of the of Jesus' garment did not work, that's when her circumstance can become hopeless, then she will need to be encouraged. But now, who is there to encourage her? Knowing that according to the law, a woman with that kind of circumstance was unclean. And touching Jesus was to make Jesus unclean. And of course, Jesus would not find it funny with her. You see why she tried to hide the matter? Because telling the matter would require her to tell Jesus that she was someone who was unclean for 12 years. And the law was still active at this time because Jesus had not died. So what are you having faith for? that does not require faith. You only need belief.
Yes, sir.
And maybe that's why the thing is not working. That's why the thing is not working. Let's tell you something. The Lord said there's peace in your marriage. He's bringing restoration.
Amen.
Does it make sense to you? Said all those troubles is caused by one woman. Said it's bringing peace.
Amen.
Said even when you get home, you see a change.
Amen.
It's peace in your marriage.
Amen.
The Lord said, don't let your heart be broken.
Amen.
He says, when you look at your family, you see things you don't like. Even in your own family, with your siblings, your mother, this thing happened. He says, no, your own marital life will not be like the others.
Amen.
Does it make sense?
Amen.
Start to your feet. See, the Lord says, your marital life will not be like your siblings. To see them having marital issues. The Lord says, for your sake, He Himself has stepped in.
Amen.
And then the Lord is saying, you are the reason why this message came.
Amen.
To heal your marriage.
Amen.
That marriage of many years.
Amen.
Sally, Pratibo, Sinkit, 12 years. Say, Pratibo, Marco, dear. The Lord said, this marital thing has affected your jobs, affected many things, but there's peace.
Amen.
Blessed is the fruit of your womb.
Amen.
Blessed is the fruit of your womb. Does it make sense? They are free.
Amen.
Say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
All right, thank you, sir. All right. The Lord just interrupted us. Okay, now let's show you some.
Thank you, Lord.
Then we'll close. Jesus said, only believe and she will be well.
Amen.
Only believe.
Amen.
That was the case. The whole circumstance look like, man. He says, if only you believe, it will be well.
Amen.
If only you believe. Yes. And it's not hard to believe. Now, the circumstance looked impossible. But in as much as the circumstance looked impossible, Jesus told the woman to do the simplest thing. Told Jairus, actually, to do the simplest thing. Just believe. See, it is when the circumstances look bleak, looks scattered, that's when God expects you to do the most simple thing. Believe. Believe what? He said, only believe and she will be made well. Now, notice, he didn't say believe that she is made well. He didn't say so. He says, only believe and she will be made well. What was he supposed to believe? He didn't tell her. That's the point. Some say, no, she was supposed to believe that he's able to make her well. Already, what he had that would have made the lady well, somebody already took it. Now, to worsen the matter, he is now being told that the lady, the young girl he was going to heal, was already dead. Jesus said, only believe. Believe what? He didn't tell. That means find something need to believe. You are the one to determine it. I can't do it for you. So there are things the Lord cannot do for you, like believe. Even when the circumstance looks impossible, he says, just believe. Just believe. Only believe. You are the one to tell what brought you here. He says, believe it. Still believe it. I know I did not make a mistake for coming to church. I believe it. That what I heard today is true.
Yes, sir. Believe it.
He says, only believe. And she will be made well. So Jesus is not, now notice what Jesus is trying to say. See, what I would have used for your daughter, someone has taken it. Now, only believe, and your belief will make her well. That's what Jesus is telling you. Okay. Your belief will raise your daughter again. That thing you saw or you heard about me that made you come to me, still believe it. Now, the thing is out of my hands. That's what Jesus was trying to tell the lady. It is no longer in my hands anymore. It is now with you. Mm-hmm. You are the one to walk the miracle now. Jesus was telling the lady, I can't do anything for you anymore. Mm-hmm. Only you can make things happen.
Amen.
See. And when he came into the house, you see that? Did you notice? The guy did not argue with Jesus anymore.
Yeah.
He kept quiet. He did not say a word anymore. Whether he believed, whether he didn't, we're not told. We're not told. But he was quiet. First of all, how do you know you believe? Remember the first thing Jesus told you. Do not be afraid. Now, the circumstance that you are faced with, is it the circumstance that is bringing fear to you? If it is something that is trying to initiate fear in you, then you know it is not faith you need. You believe. See. Which circumstance now looks bleak? And it looks like, hey, what if I don't get that job? What if I get? No. I believe that job is mine. That's it. Not what if not? No. He says, don't be afraid. So when your mind is vacillating, what if not? The thing to do, the right thing to do is, I refuse to fear.
I refuse to fear.
What is fear? What if not? What if not? Jesus said, don't be afraid. So, how many of you have a what if not? What if she gets well? What if she doesn't get well? What if he's fine? What if he's not fine?
I refuse to fear.
What if what brother Otis is telling me is true? What if he's not? What if he's just trying to make me feel good? What is not? Say, where I refuse to fear.
I refuse to fear.
So it doesn't matter what prophecy says to me anymore. I just know I refuse to fear.
I
believe that I'm not afraid.
I believe that I'm not afraid.
Yes, sir.
Worst comes to worst, I'm not afraid.
I am not afraid.
Yeah.
Amen.
Is this the best you could do, Mr. Devil? Is this the best? Is this your best? The worst the enemy could do to Jairus was to take the daughter's life. Jesus said, your belief will bring her back. What you believe? Listen, if you can take hold of what we're telling you, there is, you will see the way you'll be flying in life. That's why we are not in New York today,
Amen.
Preaching in New York. The Lord brought us here to come and preach this to you. Because God has you present here in mind. To move you, including those watching us. To move you. Because right now it looks like the whole circumstance is dead around you. It looks like the whole circumstance is so bleak. You don't know when the circumstances will end. At that point, that's not when to exercise faith. That's only when to believe. It's up to you. That means that's the time to stop talking. To people. And discussing what is happening, what is not, what is happening. Notice, Jairus was quiet. Sometimes we feel that it is when we talk, we are talking faith. Jesus says, shut up. That's just the way to believe. How do you have to believe? Keep quiet. Refuse to hear. That's how to act your belief. We were not told Jairus believed anything. We were just told he was quiet. And he followed Jesus till he got to his house. And the guy did not cry. He had the opportunity to cry. But Jesus said, don't be afraid. So I said, I'm not afraid, just that when I think about what is happening to me, I cry. Jesus said, don't be afraid. Okay, take a seat. Let's show you something. He says, if only you believe,
I believe
everything will be made well.
Amen.
So you can live a wellness life.
Yes, sir.
By your belief.
Yes, sir.
What do you believe?
The word works.
Exactly. I believe the word works. Yes, sir. Yes. What do you believe? It's up to you. I believe my exams are well.
I believe my exams are well.
I believe it.
I believe it.
That's why I don't need people around me who tell me this exam is very difficult. No, I don't need those people around me. Don't need. This is quiet time.
Yeah.
This is compulsory quiet time. The best time to have quiet time for Jairus now. He was always carried away by church activity. For crisis. A hopeless situation created a compulsory quiet time for him where his belief was not required. Sometimes we think it is the prayer of the man of God that works the miracle. It is probably the belief of the recipient of the miracle. It is the belief of the recipient. The belief. Their belief brought the miracle to light. Their belief brought the miracle to light. Now, let us show you something. Verses 51. When he came into the house, he permitted no one to go in except Peter, James, and John, and the father and mother of the girl. See that? Five people with him. Now, all wept and mourned for her. You see that? So Jesus was saying, don't be like them.
Yeah.
That's why I told him, don't be afraid, only believe. So the people who cry are those without belief.
Yeah.
But you have it. Jairus didn't know he had it. Jesus had to tell him, you have it. Only believe. You know, there's a great man of God by the name of Evangelist Dr. Maurice Cerullo, and his ministry had a situation one time. He narrated the story, and he said it was a big issue for his ministry in the state of California, and his members of staff were running helter skelter. How we were going to resolve the crisis and all that. For the ministry, and they would just see him walk He will come to the office and just see the staff. How are you doing today? He will just laugh and go. And so he did that from time to time. He will just. So one of the staff walked up to him and said, "Brother Cerullo, do you mind talking? Do you mind if I talk with you?" He said, "I noticed that in this crisis, you are aware of this crisis. It can sink your ministry. And meanwhile, it is your face that is on it and all that." He said, "Yes, I'm fully aware of it." He said, "But it doesn't look like you are serious about it." He said, "No. No, I wouldn't waste my time focusing on that. You're correct. I'm not serious about the matter." He said, "But we are all serious about it." He said, "Well, I never told you guys to be serious about the matter." So he asked him, "So what do you mean?" He said, "Well, it's God's business. Let him fix it. It's not my business. He called me into the ministry. It is his business. Let him fix it. So let's just go and have fun." And that's how the matter died. He said, "I was minding my business as an orphan in an orphanage, as a Jew, when God called me into the ministry. So if he didn't know that there was going to be this crisis, even if I was the one who made the mistake, let him fix it." And that's how the matter died 2 days after. A pastor came and met him and said, "Brother Cerullo, that crisis, thank God for your faith. I've always believed that you're a man of faith." He said, "My faith did nothing. That's not where I exercise my faith." I didn't exercise my faith there. But they were ascribing him to be a man of great faith. He now told them, "I did not flinch, exercise any iota of faith towards the circumstance. I just know the thing will die down." Why? Belief. See, his belief made him quiet. You see, his fears, the fears of the staffs, made them talk, and they were panicking. Fear. But for him, his belief silenced every talk. See, sometimes some people believe that it is when they are going through issues, that's when they need to talk. And they think that even when they talk positive, that's faith. That's cowardice. As far as Jesus is concerned, that's stupidity. The woman with the issue of blood who even had faith did not even talk. She just said, "For she said, if I be touched," so she acted.
Yes, sir.
She acted. Faith is acting, not talking. People think, one of the mistakes Christians make in the churches today, they think faith is talking.
Yeah.
Faith is not talking. Faith is acting.
Yes.
You understand? When we got this place, if you will ask me, my faith was only for a portion of it. Then the Lord said, "You can have this thing." So I said to Pastor, "Man, we can take this, you know." Pastor said, "We can do it, sir." Man. I said, "Oh man, our finances." She said, "No, sir, trust me, we can do this."
Amen.
"See, let's do it." I looked at Pastor said, "Sir, let's do it, we can take it." Come on, God's people will give.
Amen.
God's people, hey, you guys have been giving.
Amen.
And we got this.
Amen.
See, faith is an act.
Yes, sir.
It's not talking. It's not talking. Each time Jesus healed the people, he will say, "Your faith made you well." And the people were not talking. They only made a decision to act. But now, after you have acted, the circumstance looks dead. That's when belief comes in. See? So I'm just going to be quiet. Rosie said I should be quiet. So my quietness is belief. No! Find something to hold on to in your mind. Not with your mouth. In your mind. Has God ever done anything for you?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus, has he ever done anything
Amen.
For you?
Amen.
So, how many of you now have been faced with a situation right now? It looks like everything is dead around you. Is there any person?
Yes, sir.
Is there any person here?
Yes.
Okay. Now, when you remember one thing God has done for you, and you believe that thing, hold on to that picture in your mind, it will settle this one.
Amen.
See, it's easy. It's easy. See, these are the mechanics to your miracle. either healing or any other area where you need victory. See, what are you making an issue of? That is really not an issue. And you have so magnified the circumstance that it looks like the circumstance is the Almighty. You have made an Almighty out of the problem. Is it having children now? You have made having children, not having children, the ultimate in your life. It looks like that's the Almighty in your life. Oh no. Or marriage, don't make it an issue. And just because people are trying to put it on you doesn't mean you need to carry it. Mm-hmm. It says, let the dead bury their dead. You are not one of their dead. See? See, those are the people. When that man came and said to Jairus, don't trouble the master again, your son is dead. He was just trying to tell Jairus, face reality. He is that, don't try to hide under the cloak of the church. You know, sometimes they think that we in the church, we are not serious people. Anything that was buried around you, that has been working against you, is uprooted now.
Amen!
Some things were buried. God is uprooting them.
Amen!
Uprooting them.
Amen!
Uprooting them. One time the Lord saved you from stepping on a charm. God saved you from stepping on a charm. There was a serious leg pain. Oh God, dispelled it.
Amen.
You understand what I was saying? It was a charm. See, in the country where you come from, in your compound, there are charms everywhere. Charms everywhere. Because of village fight. This or that village, fighting this village. This or that village. You understand what I was saying? Fighting. So they bury charms for protection, but now those charms are working against members of the family.
Amen.
You understand? That's why the ladies in our family, they think the chance really affected women in their family. Then their men were dying early. But now there's restoration.
Amen!
God is uprooting everything.
Amen!
Those chances, they have all expired.
Amen!
Now, they've expired.
Amen!
Now. So your household does not need prayer anymore for cleansing and all that. No, they are free.
Amen.
They are free now. You see, light has come.
Amen.
Darkness, you are free. You don't need prayer. Okay. Now, Jesus, verse 52. Now, all wept and mourned for her. But he said, do not weep. She is not dead, but sleeping. That will tell you something. Do you know what Jesus just did? He spoke his belief. As far as he was concerned, she was sleeping. That's what he believed. They spoke their belief that she was dead. 2 Corinthians 4:13. Put your marker there. Read 2 Corinthians 4:13. We'll close with that. 2 Corinthians 4:13. What does it say? It says, we, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. You see? You speak what? You speak your belief. You don't speak faith. He says, we also believe and therefore speak. So what do you speak? You speak your belief. You see what Jesus said? You shall have whatever you say. What do you say? Your faith or your belief?
Your belief.
Do you realize when you say to someone, good morning, you just spoke your belief? And when the guy says, what is good about the morning? It's just what they have believed. They believe that nothing is good. Now, do you realize that if you are conscious that anything you say is what you believe, you'll be careful what you say.
Yes,
all that we've taught you now is what I believe. That's what we're speaking to. And I got it from the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit spoke what he believed to me, and I believed it, and I'm speaking it back to you. I believe I'm a successful
woman. I believe I'm a successful woman.
I'm not speaking faith.
I am not speaking faith.
Do you understand? What is faith meant for? Romans chapter 6. Right? Romans chapter 12, verses 6. When you read from verses 3 down to verses 8. Romans chapter 12, verses 3 down to verses 8. It tells us faith is for service. You use faith in carrying out services in the house of God. Whether in giving, in all those things you do as a minister, whether in teaching, in exhortation, you use, Paul says, let us use them. So faith is something you use for service in the house of God. But what do we speak? We speak our belief for what? For the impossible to become what? Possible. What people have done is to relegate belief to nothing. Meanwhile, what we speak is our belief. Jesus said, if you shall say to this mountain, Mark 11:23, and believe in your heart, it is and have faith in your heart. Believe in your heart. Because of what you believe in your heart, you say what you believe. To what? To the mountain. And believe in your heart. He says, and do not doubt what you said. Because doubting what you said would mean doubting your beliefs. See? He says, if you shall say unto this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and do not doubt in your heart. But believe that what you said. See, you believe that what you said. So even when you say something, believe it. Say, believe that what you said will come to pass. It will come to pass. It doesn't matter how long it takes, it will surely come to pass. Then Jesus said, you would have what you said. So belief is what causes a man to have whatever he or she sees. What's your belief? Learn to feed your belief. When we studied the word, what do you think we are feeding? Our faith or our belief?
Our belief.
And as we feed our belief, we speak it and we have what we say and then increase our faith for service. See? If I speak what I believe, faith comes when I act it. I believe I have what I say.
I believe I have what I say.
That your future is bright.
Amen.
I believe it. Listen, as far as this ministry is concerned, in this Mangora, no one knows your future more than Brother Ozzy, as God has granted us the privilege to oversee this particular church. Which means we should know your future. And we've seen it. And it's very bright.
Amen.
It's very glorious.
Amen.
Your future is a future where the impossible becomes possible.
Amen.
Where people will be asking, how did you do it?
Amen.
How did it work? What was the magic? The magic is your belief.
Amen.
See, your belief brought you here.
Yes.
So, the worst thing you can do to you is to doubt your own belief. So when you see a poor man, that's a man who does what? Who believes in poverty. And such people speak their poverty. And that's why they are poor. They always have poverty. I refuse to be poor.
I refuse to be poor.
I don't believe in poverty.
I don't believe in poverty.
That's why I can never be poor. I believe in riches.
I believe in success.
I believe in marital peace.
I believe in fruitfulness.
I believe in favor.
I believe in favor.
It doesn't sound like you mean it.
I believe in favor.
You see what I say? I'm a success forevermore.
I'm a success forevermore.
Well, now, in conclusion, Jesus said, do not weep. She is not dead, but sleeping. And they ridiculed him, knowing that she was dead. See, that's what they knew. No wonder they expressed what they believed. They believed in death. Jesus didn't. Jesus preferred to believe in sleep. They believed in death. So they laughed at him. So they laughed at Jesus by making him feel like something is wrong with his belief. That's why they laughed. Okay. Can we all stand, please? Let us show you something. But he now put them all outside. So you see, chase away people who don't believe what you believe.
Yes.
Cut away from them.
Yes,
that's the first thing. People who have issues with what you believe, separate from them. They may have your kind of faith, but as long as they don't have your kind of belief, cut them off. We can have the same common faith because God, or every faith, the faith itself, it came from God. So we may have common faith, but there's no such thing as common belief. There's no such thing as common belief. You see? Take your seat, please. There are Christians today who believe in the virgin birth. Right?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, here's the point. We're about to tell you something. There are people who believe in the virgin birth. I know about the virgin birth. Follow what I'm about to tell you.
Yes, sir.
But it doesn't mean I believe it. Somebody says, you mean you don't believe it? I'm not saying that I don't believe it. It has nothing whatsoever to do with my salvation. The virgin birth is not what made me a Christian. What made me a Christian was that I was commanded by scriptures, Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, to believe the resurrection. The virgin birth, believing it would not do anything to me. That's the point.
Yes, sir.
Do I know about the virgin birth?
Yes.
I do. Isaiah talked about it in Isaiah chapter 7. So I know it, but it doesn't mean I believe it because it has nothing to do with my salvation. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
So putting it as one of the tenets of the church, I believe in the virgin birth, is not what makes you a Christian. The only time that remark can only be useful is if I have someone who is experiencing barrenness. Then I come and say, do you believe that a virgin gave birth? If a virgin can give birth, you can have a child. That's the only time that virgin birth can be useful. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
See, the one who already has children does not pray to have children.
Yes.
So tell him, come to preach a sermon that you have children. All of you have them. That's me. That's not what I came to church for. Did you understand?
Yes.
So you see, the gospel of having children now is not useful to that person.
Yes.
But if the person says, it is money that I need, say, God will prosper. If the person says, say, hey, now you are talking. Amen. I receive. I receive. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So you see, beliefs, therefore, is not common.
Yes,
by that we mean it is not uniform. It is relative to the individual.
Yes.
Some people believe that God is a triangle. Some believe that God is a square. Some believe that God is a cloud. God, some believe that God is... Well, as they believe, they speak.
Yeah.
We can have common faith, but not common belief.
Yeah.
So, yes, the virgin birth was written about. The angel came to a virgin. I know about it. It doesn't mean I need to believe it for my salvation. Because what I've been commanded to believe is the resurrection, which has brought me righteousness. He says, with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness. And what do I believe with my heart? The resurrection. If believing the resurrection has brought me righteousness, it is far greater than the virgin birth.
Yes, sir.
That's the point. People think that the virgin birth is more supernatural than the resurrection. It's not. You know what it means for a man to die and rise up never to die again? Never to die again. Even Mary the Virgin died. But that this one died and rose from the dead, never to die again. Do you understand? So it is not a tenet of the belief to say, I believe in the Virgin Birth, therefore, since I believe in the Virgin Birth, I'm saved. No, I know a virgin gave birth.
Yes.
I know about it. It is not a lie that the virgin gave birth. It is true. But like we said, it is not what makes you a Christian. As a matter of fact, Isaiah chapter 7 said it was supposed to be a sign to the people of Judah. It has nothing to do with us as Christians. So if I say I don't believe, it doesn't make me a sinner. Because it was not supposed to be for me. It was supposed to be for the people of Judah in the days of Isaiah. See? So, and Jesus came 2,000 years back. So, it was something that ended with that era. Yes, did it happen? Yes. Your history today, do you believe it all? Do you believe everything in your history?
No.
Or does it mean that you don't know much about your history in America? You know a lot about America.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Were you there? No. You believe the stories that are being narrated. Fine. Is it that you live it?
No.
Has it done anything for you?
No.
But you know the one that can produce for you.
Yes,
Jesus even said, it's amazing. Jesus did not even say, believe that I was born of a virgin. Jesus didn't say, believe that I was born of a virgin. Then you have a miracle. No. He didn't even say, believe the virgin birth. Then you will move mountains. He didn't say so. He says, believe what you see. So two things to focus your belief in. The first one, the resurrection from the dead, which makes you righteous. Then the next one, which is the most important in your life, having believed in the resurrection, is to always believe what you say. That's all. So say, well, I believe what I say, that the Mary is a virgin that gave birth. Okay, fine. It's okay. It's not a problem. If believing it is what will move your mountains, fine. Isn't that amazing? You that believe you still come to me. Who know about the virgin birth? But like we said, it is not the basis of my salvation.
Yeah.
And that's the honest truth. It's just the honest truth.
Yeah.
This one is not about, oh, you are discriminating denominations. No. We appreciate them. But the truth of the matter is that the Bible talks about studying to show yourself approved, a workman that needs not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And that's what we just did. We're showing you rightly. Yes, the Bible talks about it. But it's not something you need to believe to be a Christian. Like the way some people are doing it. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Some will be amazed when they get to the corridors of heaven and God says, man, brother, what are you coming here for? Lord, you know I believe in the Virgin Birth. God said there are so many virgins who even have children. You'll be amazed. But there's a point. You know what we're saying in conclusion. You are the reason why we have not concluded. Verse 54. But he put them all outside.
Amen.
Took her by the hand and called, saying, little girl, arise.
Amen.
Now, read verses 55.
Then the spirit returned,
and she arose immediately, and he commanded them to give her something to eat. Now, look on. When I got to this part, while studying, there was something the Lord said to me that baffled me. Do you know? The daughter, the whole story began with this Jairus having a daughter who was dying at age 12.
Yes, sir.
And Jairus came to Jesus to come and heal her. Okay, Jesus was intercepted by the woman with the issue of blood who had suffered that plague for 12 years. She received her own. Okay, Jairus was told the daughter is dead. Jesus said, only believe and she will be made well. He came now and said, she's sleeping, she's not dead. The people laughed Jesus to scorn, knowing that the child is dead. When Jesus drew them outside, then he came and said, daughter, he asked Peter, James, and John to follow him with the father and mother. Then he came and tapped the daughter and said, daughter, arise. So now here, one lady touched him, the man with the issue of blood, he is now touching a little girl. Okay, now here's the point. The daughter arose. Now, that did not in any way mean that the daughter was healed. See, there's a difference between the working of miracles and the gift of healing. The daughter needed healing. She didn't need a miracle. You know, generally, we use the expression, it's a miracle. When somebody is healed, we say, it's a miracle. Really, healing is not the same as a miracle. They are two different things. Healing is the manifestation of the mercy of God upon the sick. The working of miracle, it is the demonstration of the power of God for judgment through a human agent. When Elijah caught fire from heaven, that is the working of miracle. Now, Jesus came and rose the daughter. Remember, Jairus did not come to meet Jesus with the intention of Jesus raising the daughter in the first place. He wanted Jesus, by the Spirit, to manifest the gift of healing, one of the gifts of healing, in healing the daughter, not working a miracle. But now, the circumstance grew worse. The daughter died. Now, she needed a miracle. It is after the miracle you cannot minister healing. But now she was raised, which was the working of miracle, so as to bring a judgment on the people who mocked Jesus. Right?
Yes, sir.
But now the healing part, Jesus did not do anything. You say why? Because really, and I was surprised what the Spirit of the Lord, when he said that to me, and I was surprised. I was very, very surprised and excited. Jairus came to Jesus for the healing of his daughter. He said, because she was dying. Jesus came, worked a miracle, and she was raised up. Okay, now, working of miracles, like we said, is not the same as the gift of healing. There are two different gifts of the Spirit. If you read Acts chapter 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 11. Now, Jesus worked the miracle of raising the daughter from the dead, the little girl from the dead, but he still did not heal her. Rather, he instructed, give her food to eat. Which means, even when she rose from the dead, she was still looking like someone who was dying.
Yeah.
So, which means Jesus is saying, your daughter really didn't need healing.
She
She just needed food. You were not feeding her right.
Wow.
That was awesome.
Amen.
Just feed her right. Each time Jesus healed the people, they were completely restored. This time around, he rose her from the dead, then he said, give her food. That means she still lacks strength.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus knew it is malnutrition. This daughter is not well fed.
Mm-hmm.
You see why he took the father and mother? He now told the mother, give her food. You don't feed your daughter right. So sometimes some things that look like sickness are not necessarily sickness. It is just because some people don't eat. So check the way you eat. You are probably not sick. It's just because you don't eat right. And that's why you look sickly. That's why you look like someone who is out of strength. That was what Jesus was trying to show us here. See, now you're disappointed.
No!
You were expecting one powerful
miracle.
You see why the woman with the issue of blood, she was the one who really needed the healing.
Yeah.
She was the one who really needed the healing.
Yes.
The little girl didn't need it. But see, they were panicking over something. Mm-hmm. You couldn't say there was no food in the house. But it's just. So if you check that story well, you discover that if you ask that little girl, what happened to you? She said, I wasn't really eating. Notice, that was how the expression was used. She was dying. Mark says she was at the point of death. But they all ended up narrating the same story. Jesus said, give her food to eat. When Lazarus was brought from the dead, when Lazarus was brought from the dead, what was it Jesus said? He said, loose him and give him food to eat. But this was the guy who was sick and died in his sickness. Right?
Yes, sir.
Please answer now.
Yes, sir.
Remember when he was sick, Jesus was invited to come and heal, and Jesus did nothing.
Yes.
Jesus came later on after the guy was dead and buried. So again, raising the guy from the dead was what? The working of miracles. But Jesus did not heal the guy. He knew malnutrition was the issue. Go and give him food, let him eat. Meanwhile, Martha liked to cook, but she was not feeding the people, right? So that you know how to cook doesn't mean you know how to feed the people. There's a difference between eating and feeding. There's something called food. Yeah? And there were no McDonald's in those days then. So we don't know what they were probably eating that. Jesus was like, man, give him food to eat. And they accused Jesus of eating too much. He's a glutton. So that means Jesus had to eat well for the sake of what? His own health. Because he was going to take beating later on. I mean, to kill him, they had to flog him to kill him. Yeah. 50 stripes with blade. I mean, he needed to have the flesh to contain it. Yeah. John the Baptist did not eat much. His ministry was over after Jesus came. And the next thing, he cut off his head. He cut off his head. So it was easy for that head to be cut off. The guy wasn't eating too much. One sword, bam, the head was rolling. Paul himself was beheaded too. And he said he did fasting all the time. And when they put the sword, the head was rolling over the cliff. For then Peter said, crucify us outside there. It's better with us outside there. He had to wear. The ones who had to wear, they put them on the cross. Anyway, don't say, because I hate when I put me on the cross. No. But you see, food is like the word of God. If the word of God is medicine to your body, food can also be medicine. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. So, how do you know which food is medicine for your body? Literal food now.
Mm-hmm.
It is the food that was provided by the word of God. Not the one. See, when you look at the money you get today, how did you get the money? If you came through schemes and all that, whatever provision you buy for the household is cost. Yeah. It will not be food. The people around you will be sick. So even though Jairus was the ruler of the synagogue, he was ruler of someone who was extorting money. Like we said, he was a minister. The woman with the issue of blood probably met him. So whatever food they gave the daughter was not working. It was killing the daughter. Didn't the Lord say, I will bless your food, and I'm Exodus 23, verse 25. I will bless your food and your drink, then I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. Until I bless your food and bread, then I will take sickness away. So one of the ways to sanctify even what you eat is to be fully involved in the things of God. Be active in the church. Find something to do in God's house. Be fully involved in it. Give towards it. Let it be that you exhausted your energy in church, and when you are going home, you are going to feed to resuscitate yourself, knowing that you still come and exert the energy for God. God will bless you.
Amen.
See? Take care of yourself. Take care of yourself.
Amen.
Otherwise, you will be like that woman. And this happened to us. Jesus raised them from the dead. He said, give them food to eat.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't need to minister healing to them. Like we said, there's a big difference between the working of miracles and healing. They are not the same. But he worked the miracle and did not heal them. He said, see, they need food. It is food. Those that needed healing didn't need to die. But those that died, that he rose from the dead through the working of miracles, he said, give them food. It is the lack of good food. That's why they fell sick in the first place and died. So stop starving yourself. So say, I want to lose weight. I want to, it's my love tummy. What do you call it?
Love handle.
Love handle. You know, when I came to America, we had this thing. Love handle.
Yeah.
That this is, so that the boyfriend can hold me very well. This is how he is reacting. They can hold me and hug me. See, God has renewed your strength now.
Amen.
Your health is restored.
Amen.
You are free in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Every sicknesses and diseases.
Amen.
Every flu, every infirmity
Amen.
Around you. We declare you free in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. We declare you free in the
Amen.
Name of Jesus. Command every sickness and disease to go from your household.
Amen.
Leave your body.
Amen.
We declare you free in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Anyone who's having issues with hearing, partial hearing, we declare your ears be open in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Be open in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Anyone that is feeling as though something is crawling in your body, we command that thing dead.
Amen.
The mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
We declare you free.
Amen.
Any swollen leg, we command it be normalized in
Amen.
The mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Be normalized in the
Amen.
Mighty name of Jesus. Be normalized in the
Amen.
Mighty name of Jesus. We command your bones, your organs, your ligaments, your tissues, the sinews in your body. We declare them free in the
Amen.
Name of Jesus. We declare your blood cleansed in the
Amen.
Mighty name of Jesus. You will never be sick again
Amen.
In your life. Your back will never lie on any hospital
Amen.
Bed.
Amen.
Mali Sopra. The words you have heard this afternoon has become medicine for your body forevermore.
Amen.
It will renew you.
Amen.
It will renew you.
Amen.
The Bible says Moses was in the presence of God. That is why his physical force did not abate.
Yeah.
That means Moses did not use a walking stick and was trying to, he was not bowed over. He was always in the presence of God. Anytime you come into the presence of God, may the Lord renew your strength.
Amen.
May the Lord renew you in the mighty
Amen.
Name of Jesus. May the Lord favor you.
Amen.
Stand to your feet and bless the name of the Lord. You are free in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Ancient of days, as old as you are, as old as you are, hallelujah. Let's sing to the Lord. Attacking your body, we command it to go from you.
Amen.
The mighty name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Begin to do what you could not do before. You discover you are free now.
Amen.
You are free now.
Amen.
You are free.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Yes, sir. I am free.
I am free.
Yeah. Do what you could not do before.
I am free.
You are free now. Yes, sir. Praise God. Praise God.
Praise God.
You will see countless testimonies in your
Amen.
Life. You are free.
Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, let's sing our Amen. Say thank you, Holy
thank
Ghost.
Thank you, Holy Ghost.
For the benefit of those who are watching us, if you have not made Jesus the Lord of your life, you have an opportunity to do so. The Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You know, sometimes there are people who say, well, I believe in God and all that. But the Bible says demons believe in God too. The Bible says demons believe in God, yet they tremble. And demons are condemned. James chapter 2, verses 19 says, demons believe in God. And demons have believed in God long before you were born, long before you became a Christian, yet they are still going to the lake of fire. So believing in God is not what will change your circumstance. Otherwise, demons would have been saved. You know, Christian, a lot of people say, I believe in God, I believe in God. Well, like we said, demons also do. It's there in the Bible, James chapter 2, verses 19. Someone said, but I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. Well, believing in Jesus was before Jesus died. But after he rose from the dead, we've all been commanded to believe his resurrection. Like we said earlier. We've all been commanded to believe his resurrection. Someone said, how about John 3:16? John 3:16 was before Jesus died. When he says, for God so loved the world, and he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him. That was before Jesus died. But after he rose from the dead, we've all been commanded to believe his resurrection. Someone said, what would that resurrection do for me? Believing that resurrection is what will make you righteous. It's not the good things you do or the charity homes you visit that makes you righteous. But by believing that resurrection, you are righteous. That's what the Bible says. So I said, how about the confession of sins? It's a good thing that you said so. The question is, Because confession of sin even brings salvation. Many preachers say it, but it's not true. The Bible never said if you confess your sins, you'll be saved. The Bible only said if you confess your sins, you'll be healed. James chapter 5, verse 16 says, confess your faults one to another, pray for one another, that ye may be healed. Confession of sins only brings you healing. It does not bring you salvation. Each time Jesus healed the people, he would say to them, your faith has made you whole. Sorry, sometimes he would say to them, your sins are forgiven thee. Forgiveness of sins requires the confession of sins, which brings about healing. See? So it does not bring you salvation, it only brings you healing. I know some people may want to say, well, healing is part of sozo and all that. No. You can be healed and still go to hell. But there's one thing we've been commanded to confess, which is the name, the lordship of the name of Jesus. It is far greater than any sin you want to confess. The Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. Confessing the lordship of the name of Jesus is far, far greater than any sin you want to confess, no matter how terrible the sins are. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It is a whosoever shall confess their sins will be saved. So confession of sin does not bring you healing. But confession of the lordship of that name is what will bring you salvation. See? Confession of sins does not bring you salvation. So we'd like you to acknowledge the lordship of Jesus. So I say, I need to see it in the Bible. Well, Romans chapter 10, verses 8 to 10. Romans chapter 10, verses 8 to 10. James chapter 2, verses 19. James chapter 2, verses 19. James chapter 5, verses 16. James chapter 5, verses 16. You read the scriptures, you see the clarity of all this. And at this point, we'd like to encourage your indulgence to join us. Those of you watching and those here, and see this after us, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Say, Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I thank you for your Son, Jesus.
I thank you for your Son, Jesus.
My Lord.
My Lord.
I call him Lord.
I call him Lord.
Because I believe.
Because I believe.
He rose from the dead.
He rose from the dead.
For my salvation.
For my salvation.
For my justification.
For my justification.
And at this moment.
And at this moment.
I confess with my mouth.
I confess with my mouth.
That Jesus Christ.
That Jesus Christ.
Is Lord of
my life. Is Lord of my life.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
To the glory of
to
God.
To the glory of God.
My Father.
My Father.
Amen.
Amen.
If you have made that declaration, I would like to congratulate you and welcome you to the family of God. Mm-hmm. I would like to pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your son and your daughter who have acknowledged the lordship of the name of Jesus. Your word says, whosoever cometh unto you, you will in no wise cast away. Father, even as these ones have come unto you, may they not be cast away. Lord, may their feet never slide. May these ones not backslide. May they never fall. May your right hand sustain them. And at the end of the day, may they spend eternity with you. Take all the glory in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen.
Let's say congratulations to them.
Congratulations!
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
All right, let's prepare our offering.